Ellen, hi. Welcome to the Saligaon Institute. This is one of our very unusual interviews.
Hi.
Because we found you and drafted you into being a dance teacher. Thank you so much. Thanks so much.
Hi, Rico.
For that.
Yeah, thank you.
So tell us about your experience in teaching dance in Bombay and Goa.
Well, otherwise, I'm an English and social studies teacher. Taught in a school and then in a college.
Bandra.
School in Mahim. And college, St. Andrew's College, I taught French. But when I came to Saligaon many, many years ago, I attended a one-man band program in this institute and found a large table of youth that was sitting and not getting up to dance. And I looked at them and I thought, why are these children not dancing? So I called one of them. And that girl happened to be the youth in charge. Her name was Stephanie, and she's today Sister Stephanie.
I know.
And so I asked Stephanie, why are the youth not dancing? And she said, Auntie, they don't know to dance. I was appalled. And I told her, I'll tell you one thing. You get the people, I'll get the music, and we'll have a dance class.
Where their church?
No, here.
Here.
So, this happened on Saturday. On Monday evening, Stephanie was in my house and she said that the youth were interested in learning to dance. So, we started the dance class on Tuesday because I was leaving back for Bombay on Saturday. So, I had Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, 4 days to teach them dance. On the first day, we had about 6 to 8 girls and maybe one boy that attended the class, and the class was to end at 7 o'clock. At about 6:45, 6:50, a whole jingbang of local boys was standing outside the institute and peeping to see who is this lady teaching these people to dance. And I moved from the side and walked straight in front of them in the front door, and I said, why didn't you all come? And they did that, and I said, come tomorrow, you're having class at 5 o'clock, please.
You don't mind people joining at any stage? It doesn't disrupt your teaching?
No, it doesn't, not at all.
I see.
And they were there the next day, not at 5, they were there at 4:30, because they didn't want to make a fool of themselves. I was surprised when I landed up at 5 to find the dance class going on and wondering whether I got the timing wrong. But strangely, we started the steps once again. Everybody got a chance to practice the steps that they had learned the previous day. And in 4 days, the children were dancing the jive, the foxtrot, the waltz and the cha-cha-cha.
Wow.
On our last day, which was Friday, Stephanie's mummy came with some samosas and cold drink, and we had a party. So that was my first dance class. And now when you met Lloyd, Lloyd suggested that
Correct.
We have another dance class. And I'm happy we have 8 students over here, of the
We are so happy that you've taken the initiative, and it's really great. But how does dance in, say, Bombay, particularly Bandra, such chic places, compare with, you know, the lack of dance in Goa? And why does it happen?
I think that the children in Bombay are more confident because the language that they speak is the English, and parents in Bombay push their children to do. They force their children to participate in dance classes from the second standard, the first standard, some of them. They force their children to learn
Western. Also.
Ballet, what do you call that?
Bharatnatyam, whatever.
Bharatnatyam, not so much,
okay.
But this jazz and hip-hop, and the children are dancing in Bombay. And
so we have more bands, but you all have the dancers.
Yes, you all have more bands, and I'm surprised that you all don't have the dancers.
Like, we have the coast, but we don't have the swimmers.
True. And I will tell you that when I attended the program on the first, I was so happy to see so many youth and young people at the program in the church, and I was so surprised that none of them came for the dance class, because I think that if you know to dance, you have a sense of self-confidence, And you're not backward to ask someone to dance. That's what I feel.
Right.
I also feel that the children here are backward because they're not fluent in English. I feel that if they practice a little
even
more,
if they know their language, they have an attitudinal problem. It's this small city, small village kind of mindset. I think so.
Okay.
It's so language is not so much, but they are a bit diffident in that sense, not like the big city kids. Anyway,
so another thing that I find that it differs between Bombay and Goa, having stayed in Goa this time for over a year, is this, that the people in Bombay are very go-getter. They have a go-getting attitude, whereas the people in Goa are very susegaad.
Laid back.
Yeah, very, very laid back. They're really not wanting to help themselves.
Yeah.
Because I'll tell you, I have a neighbor who's...
A bit defeatist also, which... defeatist, they're defeatist, but it's not always a bad thing, but you know, it can be a problem in terms of, you know, self-growth and personality development and whatever.
True.
Because confidence comes from all these small victories that you notch up along the way, and if you don't get started, you're not going to.
True. Very much so.
Tell us about your website, last thing.
My website is
a YouTube
website that I started. Not website, it's a YouTube channel that I started. I started it when the lockdown began. So I wanted to put up this YouTube channel because my students whom I taught French told me that I have so many life lessons that I teach them while I'm teaching the subject that I should make it available to the world. So I named my YouTube channel Teacher Grandma, which is a channel that named after my mother. That's what my children used to call my mother. So it's in honor of my mother, actually. And I've put many life lessons that I've learned from the smart lady. I've also put a few French videos and a few English.
So Teacher Grandma. Just go
Teacher
to YouTube,
Grandma.
Teacher Grandma.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Yeah. And the initiative at Bombay, which you sent me the message about, that's called the Leti Development Center.
Leti Training Center.
How does that work?
The Leti Training Center is a archdiocese run training center, which is headed by Father Patrick de Mello.
Who's a former chartered accountant.
Who's a former chartered accountant. My God, you
no,
done
no, I
homework.
Just, I was curious, so I just did a bit of Googling,
research,
that's all.
Yeah. So he's very interested in training the youth, the laity, to be more confident, to understand themselves, to build marriages up, to build people up. And so we have many short programs,
religious,
some not so
non-religious,
religious. Laity. It's for the laity.
I see.
So
life skills.
Yes, we have positive parenting, which is a new style of parenting. We have marriage and family enrichment. We have a counseling course, which is doing fantastically well. It just changes your perspective of life.
To build counselors.
To teach you to have the skill of being a counselor. Not to build to become a counselor, you have to do your master's in psychology. So that is what you require. But as a counselor, why do people go to a counselor? Because a counselor listens to them and makes them feel welcome and doesn't judge them. So we teach people how to communicate effectively. So I'm working now online with Father Patrick.
Thank you so much for sharing and downloading all this information, which we have so much to learn from. And of course, thank you especially for these dance classes, which mean a lot to keeping the club active and teaching new skills.
Most welcome, Frederick.
Doesn't want to go off.